Number 10, Black Widow. Alright, so granted, this is from a what if, so in terms of the main continuity, it doesn't really count, but after her apparent death in the MCU, you know I gotta throw my girl Natasha a bone. And besides, I'm always talking about her awful ultimate version on our list lately, so it's redemption time for Natasha. In What If Age of Ultron issue 3, Black Widow became a god after Thor fell. Many supers and dear friends had also fallen at this point, and so it was up to Natasha to try and wield the hammer of Thor. She had to battle her way to Mjolnir, but ended up successful in retrieving it, managing even to be deemed worthy enough to lift it, and transforming her into her own version of the Thunder God. She ended up defeating the great Midgard serpent Jormungand, and while others fell in the battle, we later found out that this version of Natasha from Earth 23223 actually managed to survive despite being thought dead at the end of the comic. Also, this is a cosplay that I need to do, so adding it to my list. Number 9. Captain America. In the events that led to Secret Wars, Black Panther realized another Earth in the sky, which apparently was destroyed. It was later discovered that this was a result of incursions created by a being known as the Great Destroyer, who was causing alternate Earths to collide. In an attempt to save both Earths, the main continuity Earth of 616 and Earth 1610, from colliding with one another, the Illuminati decided to give Captain America the Infinity Gauntlet. Cap, being the kind-hearted soul he is, did not let this power go to his head and could not bring himself to destroy the other Earth. Instead, he used the gauntlet to push the two Earths as far away from one another as he could muster. Unfortunately, this caused the Infinity Stones to shatter, taking Cap back from God mode to plain old super soldier mode in a matter of minutes. Also, it didn't work, so. Number 8, Jane Foster. While Jane Foster was often more resigned originally to being simply a love interest of Thor's, her character has grown immeasurably in the comics. After answering the call of Thor's hammer, she became both a superhero and god instantly. Wielding Thor's hammer seemed to grant her all of Thor's powers and abilities. To me, this kind of felt like a throwback to the days where the hammer seemed to be the source almost of Thor's power, back when he had his alter ego Donald Blake, who now is actually his own being separate from Thor. Figure that. But becoming the goddess of thunder was not actually the only time that Jane became godlike. Odin also once tested her by turning her into an Asgardian and giving her powers, though he quickly took this away from her after declaring she had failed the test due to the fact that she was confused as to, you know, why she had powers and, like, what's going on Asgard. Odin can be such a jerk. And then there was that time that Thor's other love, Sif, merged with Jane to save her life when she was deathly ill. So, she's been a god a few times. Number 7, Wolverine. Wolverine is actually one of the best people to give godlike powers to. I know, surprising. Because he is often quick to use them and then just lose them. When he found himself possessed by the Phoenix Force during a team up with Spidey, where they were both stuck being tossed about through time, he ended up actually being able to eventually kick the entity out of him. And then there is the time in Uncanny X-Men Annual Issue 11, where he accidentally bled onto the psychedelic crystal of Ultimate Vision as he was dying. This crystal gave him the power to be resurrected from just a single drop of blood that had touched it, and allowed him to single-handedly defeat the villain Horde, transforming him into a god. But Wolverine, being Wolverine, could not be seduced by the power and decided to give it up by shattering the crystal, even if it meant that he might be destroyed in the process. Luckily, he wasn't destroyed. Neither were any of the X-Men, that he was like, they might be destroyed, but worth it. Number 6, Spider-Man. I know you guys have all been waiting for this one, because of our last thumbnail on the previous video. During the run of the original Spider-Man series, Amazing Spider-Man, Peter found himself endowed with the power of Captain Universe. Although he would end up losing the godlike powers granted to him by the Enigma Force, there is another version of Peter on Earth 13 who decided to hold on to these powers, and yet another alternate who received the powers of Captain Universe on Earth 91110. On Earth 13, this god mode alternate met his end after facing off with Solus of the Inheritors. Despite being a god, his powers were attached to the life force, which energy vampires like the Inheritors feed off of. Solus, being as powerful as he was, managed to have a hearty enough appetite and be strong enough to devour the Enigma Force, killing Earth 13's Peter Parker. Sad. No more cosmic Spider-Man. Bye. Number 5, Spawn. Spawn Bond discovers that Armageddon is nigh, and that his ex-wife's children, Katie and Jake, are actually Satan and God, respectively, incarnate. There is a being known to be even above them, though, their mother, who actually gifted Satan and God with the Earth to arrange as they saw fit. Basically, Satan and God are kind of just like cosmic children. However, their mother was disappointed and decided to put them inside the bodies of humans so they would hopefully learn something and just get along for once. This, however, failed, and they continued to wage war on one another. Spawn discovers that he may be the only one who can stop them, and sets out to prove himself worthy and eat some of the forbidden fruit, which will give him the strength that he needs. Presumably. He falls in battle after facing Judas, and the mother reveals that he has succeeded in the test and was meant to die in order to be resurrected, a la Jesus. Because apparently she was Jesus. At one point. Anyways. She gives him the fruit, which grants him the powers of the mother, turning him into a god. He ends up using the power to defeat both Satan and God, and recreate the Earth. Kind of ultimate god mode. Number 4, Superman Prime. Superman Prime comes to us from the DC 1 Million series. This version of Kal-El ends up leaving Earth around the 21st century after everyone he loved has died. You'd think being an immortal being, he would have just tried, you know, make some new friends as his old ones were dying. But you know, I guess he decided to not do that and just be a really lonely guy. He ends up leaving Earth to have fun space adventures where he is rumored to have traveled beyond time and space. How does one even do that? How do you travel beyond time and space? Does that make sense? I don't know. Only Kal-El could manage it after about 680 centuries away. That's right, he was gone for 680 centuries. It's a long amount of time. He returns and kind of makes a power cult with his descendants, bestowing them with powers he gained in his travels, so long as they promise to use them for good. Then he returns to his Fortress of Solitude inside the sun, popping back out to help deal with Solaris, an evil artificial sun who Green Lantern began to destroy by causing it to begin to supernova. Superman Prime steps in and simply just squashes the threat of Solaris. He also would later use his power and some DNA, which he retrieved from inside Solaris, to resurrect Lois Lane, who then became Silver. Silver and gold, silver and gold. Number 3, Adam Warlock. When the MCU turned to the comic book arc of the Infinity Gauntlet, we all thought for sure we'd be getting Adam Warlock, right? Whose existence in the MCU was teased at during one of the post-credit scenes for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Why? Well, because Adam Warlock understands these stones on a whole other level, and he was actually the one to wield the glove in the original story and put an end to the chaos, not Iron Man. Sorry, Stark fans, sorry about that. Beyond that, in an alternate reality, Warlock also became the new living tribunal, transforming him into a god that stands for justice on a universal scale. Basically, if you're a cosmic superhero, you're definitely gonna have some godlike abilities at some point. Number 2, Franklin Richards. Franklin Richards is probably one of the strongest mutants on the planet. He is the son of Sue Storm and Reed Richards, and I feel like constantly steals the limelight from his sister Valeria when it comes to how OP he is considered within the comics. Well, I'm sure he didn't instantly have powers when he was born, as most mutants do not actually seem to gain their powers until they hit puberty. He definitely was an early developer. This is a child who had to have his mind shut down as a baby by his dad, Mr. Fantastic, as apparently Franklin was revealed to be already too strong and dangerous when he was kidnapped and put in a device that would, granted, unlock the full potential of his psionic abilities. So, okay, maybe sure. But still, he was a baby, a baby. Franklin, as a young boy, also created a pocket universe after Onslaught killed his parents, which he kept inside a blue rubber ball, effectively saving his mom and dad and everyone else Onslaught had killed. Oh, and he and Galactus also end up becoming BFFs. Godlike beings gotta stick together, right? Know you're like a god if you're friends with Galactus. That's what I think. Number 1, Dr. Manhattan. John was sort of already granted godlike abilities as soon as he became the victim of an accident involving a radioactive particle test. It would take him a while, of course, to reform and come to this conclusion. But although this story is therefore more about John Osterman becoming a god, Dr. Manhattan really wasn't fully aware of how godlike his mind was becoming initially. As time progressed, he experienced a detachment to life that he eventually realized kept him separate and allowed him to see himself as being above humanity. The way he was able to view time and the value he put on human life eventually made him not only godlike in ability, but also in his viewpoint. Though he did end up rediscovering the miracle of life when he allowed the Silk Spectre, his former partner Lori, to view the world as he did, and they both discovered that the comedian was actually her father. He was like, wow, that's so amazing. Actually, human life's pretty cool. It's like a miracle. How did your mom and the comedian hook up? That's terrible. Number 10, Shazam. Technically, every time Billy Batson transforms using the word Shazam, he becomes six different gods all rolled into one. He gets his powers from these six gods: Solomon, Hercules, Atlas, Zeus, Achilles, and Mercury. I put quotations around the word gods because some are not really known as gods based on our own stories of them. Solomon was a king, and Achilles was a war hero. And it's a little weird that they went with the Roman version of Hermes, Mercury, but stuck to the Greek god names for the other gods mentioned. Still, in the event of the Dark Side War, it is revealed to Billy that he is actually the god of gods, and that the death of Darkseid has severed his ties to the godly powers within him. So the wizard makes new gods to reside within Batson, where he will get his strength from. Number 9. Storm. Are you truly a god without people to believe in you? When Aurora Moreau returned to her homeland of Kenya, she found herself worshipped for her mutant abilities, believed by local tribes to be a goddess. This not only made her a god in the eyes of others, but she would go on throughout her time with the X-Men to truly prove that she was deserving of the god title. When going up against Dr. Doom in Uncanny X-Men issue 147, she proves just how strong she is when Dr. Doom tortures her by encasing her entire body in chrome, preying on her claustrophobia. This unleashes a power from within Aurora, which her fellow X-Men liken to that of the Phoenix Force in terms of her power levels and her reach. I believe she actually puts the entire world under like a storm, so pretty OP. Number 8. Batman. During the events of the Dark Side War, it seemed like all the supers were getting extra powered, Batman not excluded. He ended up finding himself in possession of Metron's prized Morbius chair. The Morbius chair grants him omniscient knowledge and turns Batman into the god of knowledge. He uses his powers to uncover Joker's secret identity and put a stop to crime before it has even happened, much to Commissioner Gordon's displeasure, as the justice system of Gotham isn't really made to prosecute criminals who have yet to commit a crime. Like, you can't do that. It's just like you have no evidence other than Batman being like, yeah, no, I saw it, it's gonna happen. Number 7. Cyclops. When it was made known that the Phoenix Force was on its way back to Earth, it created a divide between the Avengers and the X-Men. The X-Men believed that the Phoenix Force could be used to fix the world after the events of M-Day. The Avengers believed that the Phoenix Force would only destroy the world. The Phoenix Force was split into five by Iron Man and became the Phoenix Five, possessing Namor, Emma Frost, Scott Summers, Magic, and Colossus. Eventually, the power was rejoined as different members of the Five fell off, losing their power and having it reabsorbed into the others, until just Scott was left. Up until the last bit of power entered him, he was actually able to stay on the light side of things, but the full power of the Phoenix Force eventually turned him dark and caused him to kill Professor X. But for a while there, he was quite godlike and quite good. Pretty impressive. Number 6. Superman. Not only Batman got to have fun during the Dark Side War event, no, no, no. The more expected hero also got a taste of what it's like to play God. And finally, too, I mean, Superman has always been one of those heroes who fans liken to a god, even just at his normal power level. During the Dark Side War, Superman found himself changed while on Apocalypse. He was granted an immense amount of strength and became known as the God of Strength, a very different and brutal version of Superman who left Lex Luthor for dead on the planet, threatening that if Lex ever returned to Earth, that he would finish the job. And he smashed all his armor. So rude. Lex kind of deserves it. Number 5. Jean Grey. You probably all know where I'm going with this one. We're talking about when Jean gets the Phoenix Force. Becoming the Phoenix and later Dark Phoenix grants Jean access to all kinds of crazy power. Remember when she ate a star and blew up a planet, inciting a war with the Shi'ar on her merry way? Now, the interesting thing is while there are many others who have found themselves possessed by the Phoenix Force, Jean is special, which also proves just how powerful it makes her. While many characters have died and been resurrected in the comics, Jean even stands out in that regard. Some believe this is due to her connection to the Phoenix Force, which sees Jean as its one true avatar. The Phoenix Force demonstrates its power in every way in which it can save her. It is even willing and capable of punching a hole through space-time to save Jean through displacing her if it has to. Just move her over there for now. Come back to her later. Number 4, The Flash. That's right, we're going back to the Darkseid War. Darkseid was killed by the Flash during this event, who had merged with the Black Racer. As a result, the Flash finds himself feuding with the Black Racer, whom he has possessed, becoming the new God of Death, involuntarily. He tries to defeat Death in his own comic, exploring this transformation, Darkseid War Flash. Here we see him try to actually outrun Death and defeat him by killing the Black Racer, with his own scythe, no less. But ultimately, Barry Allen realizes that you cannot fight the inevitable and accepts Death, giving in and merging with the Black Racer and becoming the new God of Death. Number 3, Scarlet Witch. Wanda Maximoff has always kind of had the capacity to act as a god, as her chaos magic abilities allow her to alter and warp reality any way she sees fit. But we didn't really get to see her play god until the events of House of M, where she altered all of reality to make an almost perfect world in terms of hers and others' liking. After her illusion was shattered and her brother was killed, Wanda suffered a psychotic break, which sent her into full-on god mode, and caused her to go one step farther than the previous delusional fantasy world she had previously created. She removed 99% of mutant population's powers with the words, "No more mutants." Later on, she would use her power once more to defeat the Phoenix Force. Although Scarlet Witch doesn't often flex these powers, when she does decide to go god mode, she is a force to be reckoned with. She may not be as godlike in the MCU, but she did manage to hold off Thanos, who is basically a god, with a single hand. So, that's something. Maybe one day MCU Scarlet Witch will also be a god. Who knows? Number 2, Hal Jordan. Hal Jordan had become possessed by the fear-feeding parasite Parallax, which caused him to become evil and power-hungry after the destruction of his home, Coast City. He killed a bunch of Green Lanterns during the pursuit of power, venturing to the home base of the Green Lantern Corps and absorbing their power battery. Hal went by the name Parallax and believed all the death would be worth it, as he planned to use his now omnipotent powers to fix the universe. Other superheroes banded together to stop him in the events of Zero Hour, but failed. However, Hal would later attempt to atone for the damage and death he had wrought by sacrificing himself to power Earth's dying sun. He would eventually become a normal human again, but not before he spent some time as the equally omnipotent cosmic hero, the Spectre, where he also had god powers. It's pretty godlike though, the Spectre. Number 1, Mr. Fantastic. As the incursion came to a boiling point, without seeing any way of avoiding the inevitable, Reed Richards gathered together as many heroes as he could and deployed life rafts with them inside, to protect them from the ultimate destruction of both universes as they collided. During the collision, it fell to Dr. Doom to try and save both universes. He became a God Emperor Doom, taking on the power of the Beyonders and creating a patchwork world built from the remnants of both Earth 616 and Earth 1610, called Battle World. The life rafts from both worlds were discovered by Dr. Strange, who was Doom's second in command, and both versions of Reed Richards, Mr. Fantastic of Earth 616 and the Maker of Earth 1610, decided to come together to put a stop to Dr. Doom, believing he was not a good choice for a god. After a fair fight against Dr. Doom and his power level reduced to even the odds, it was decided that Richards was the better choice when it came to someone rebuilding the universe. He was given Molecule Man's power, who had been powering Doom previously, and created the Marvelverse that we know today, even showing kindness to Victor Von Doom by fixing his scars and altering his memories so that he believed his nemesis Richards was actually dead. Aw, so nice. But he gets rescarred later, so poor Victor. Number 10, Wolverine. Wolverine has actually gone god mode more than once in the comics, though being as smart and wise as Wolverine is, he has a tendency to shun that kind of power, understanding the great responsibility that comes with it, and not trusting himself to wield such immense power. When Wolverine came into contact and merged with the Crystal of Ultimate Vision, he was granted god-level power and cosmic omniscience. He used his power to defeat Horde, whom the X-Men were fighting at the time, and then used it to return to normal, preferring to just be plain old Logan, as opposed to any godlike being. A similar instance occurred when he was imbued with the Phoenix Force and rejected it during some time traveling adventures that he had with Spider-Man. He was like, "Phoenix Force, get out of here." I feel like that's really hard to do, actually. We should give Wolverine more respect for that, even though he's apparently supposed to be beta level. Number 9. Juggernaut. One could argue that with the powers granted to him by Sidorak, Kane Marco became a god simply when he became the Juggernaut. With the powers given by the gem, Kane was granted an insane level of strength, virtual immortality, and a powerful healing factor. Beyond that, he is also almost completely impervious to exhaustion, and does not need to drink, eat, sleep, or even breathe in order to survive. But if that isn't enough to convince you, he also became a different kind of god in league with the Serpent during the Fear Itself event. Juggernaut was granted his own hammer, which allowed him to become powerful enough to escape the raft and set other prisoners free as well, inciting a mass prison break. He also took on an entire team of the X-Men during this event, and overpowered pretty much all of them. Even when they managed to get his helmet off, he resisted Emma Frost's attempts to telepathically control him. So whether we are talking about Kane Marco as Kurth, Breaker of Stone from Fear Itself, or as Juggernaut, he's pretty god level either way. Number 8. Legion. When Legion utilizes the right personas and personalities, he becomes godlike in terms of his powers. While he doesn't do it as often as some other mutants, he actually has the power to reality warp. When Dr. Nemesis and Professor Xavier was helping to cure David of his multiple personality disorder by going into his mind and erasing them from existence, Legion's mind fought back. It created a new persona to protect Legion. This persona was known as X. It adopted the face of Moira McTaggart and was able to warp reality. This new reality that it built was one wherein David Haller was seen as a hero, saving his mind from being tampered with further, and where the X-Men were simply pawns of X's used to create the landscape in which David would be seen this way. It was a pretty cool reality, actually. I will say. Number 7. Magneto. Magneto once held the Celestial together while the X-Men aimed to defeat Mr. Sinister. Sinister had taken control of the Celestial's head and was using it and Cyclops' psyche to create an army of Sinister clones to fight the X-Men. Magneto single-handedly kept the Celestial from falling apart as a result of losing its head, using his electromagnetic powers. Beyond his extraordinary control over his power set, one of the things I've always thought that has helped Magneto to achieve god status pretty much all the time, in my opinion, as a mutant, is his firm belief that he already is worthy of that title or classification. His ego and his belief in himself and his abilities. It's also part of the reason that I love him as a character, to be honest. Him and Dr. Doom both have this going on as villains. They're very self-assured. In House of X Volume 1, we get a great ego flex moment from Magneto, proving that he sees himself this way. When gathering the visiting ambassadors from all over the world in Jerusalem, they ask why he picked Jerusalem, and he tells them that it was chosen for its symbolism, as with Krakoa and the mutants on the rise, the nations of the world have new gods now. Ooh, I love that moment. Such a good Magneto moment. Number 6. Gambit. In Volume 3 of Gambit's self-titled series out of 1999, we meet New Sun, who we later find out is actually Gambit of Alternate Earth in 9921. This version of Gambit, however, has had his full potential unlocked and his powers augmented somewhat with magic. As a result, New Sun eventually reveals that his rise in power led to the devastation of his Earth. His plan is to prevent this from happening to Gambit's Earth of 616 by, well, killing Remy. During the fight between Gambit and New Sun, Gambit taps into the full potential of his powers and manages to overload New Sun with a ton of energy, resulting in New Sun and his Earth's complete destruction. Afterwards, Gambit returned home with an even more profound understanding for just how dangerous his powers really could be if left unchecked. So yeah, not only is he a god in an alternate reality, but he definitely could be god in Earth 616. It just doesn't really want to be. Number 5. Storm. Storm has been referred to as a goddess for many years in the comics, one, because she is a queen, but also because people actually believed that she was a goddess. Well, in Black Panther issue 172, Marvel made this title official. In it, we see Storm take on the ancient deity known as the Adversary, or alternatively, the Great Trickster, Nayz, or Sefako, the twice-risen god. And it is during this fight that Storm finally accepts and claims her heritage as a true divine being and goddess. This acceptance grants her the strength to defeat the Adversary and once and for all be proven to be the true goddess we always suspected that she was, and believed that she was, really. Also, this issue is pretty cute. If you're a lover of the Black Panther Storm ship, you should definitely check it out. It's so cute! Even if they sometimes have different opinions on things, they can make it work. Number 4, the Five. The Five are a group of mutants who were elevated to god status through working together in the Dawn of X relaunch. We are first introduced to them as a group in the House of X. On the mutant nation of Krakoa, these five mutants, Tempest, Hope Summers, Elixir, Proteus, and Gold Balls, now known as Egg, are revered as gods, due to the role that they play in this new mutant world. They are responsible for reviving the population of mutants through bringing back mutants who once perished in the past, and in guaranteeing all the mutants of Krakoa's immortality and safety through means of resurrecting any mutants who die moving forward, which we've already seen them do multiple times. So if you stick together, sometimes you can become a god as a group. God group. Number 3, Apocalypse. If there was any mutant who could be considered a god in their current form, it would definitely be Apocalypse. On Sabaneur has aspired to become like the ancient Egyptian deities since he was young. His original ability to alter and control his body on a molecular level was enhanced when he interacted with the tech of a celestial ship. As such, he boasts of the power of immortality, enhanced survival and evolutionary abilities via being able to control his own molecular structure, teleportation, telepathy, telekinesis, and a superb tough and strong physique. Being imbued with celestial energy also allows him to do all sorts of insane stuff when it comes to energy projection and manipulation. Apocalypse's powers have continued to grow as time has progressed, and who knows even how much stronger he will become over time. He may even surpass god level at some point, and then we'll just have to invent another word to even be able to describe how powerful he is. Like, I just think, give Apocalypse some time, and he's constantly evolving. Number 2, Franklin Richards. Many don't think of Franklin as a mutant because he is so tied to the Fantastic Four, but he is one. In fact, during House of X, Cyclops even reminded the FF that Franklin would be welcome to join his mutant family whenever he so chose in Krakoa. Which honestly, I would love to see happen. Can we see that happen already? I feel like it would give Franklin's character more opportunity to grow and become more independent. Though even while being so intrinsically tied to his family, Franklin definitely has the ability to be independent at any point should he choose. His reality warping powers are on a level to challenge any other mutant or superpowered being with such abilities. Remember when he saved everyone from Onslaught as a little boy by transporting them to a pocket universe of his own creation? Jeez. And we've seen some of the things he can do in the future when he gets older. It's all pretty crazy, to be honest. Number 1, Jean Grey. With Jean Grey's intense connection to the Phoenix Force as its more desired and main squeeze of a host, she is likely one of the most powerful mutants around, and perhaps one of the most powerful beings overall in the entire Marvelverse. Her empathic abilities are what originally drew the Phoenix Force to her. She is able to feel as well as alter other people's emotions using these abilities, though they aren't always written in as being a thing. So sometimes she has empathic abilities, sometimes she doesn't. Still, even without them, Jean has been known to be one of the most powerful telepaths and, more recently, telekinetics to ever exist. There is almost nothing that Jean can't do with her powers, so great is her control over them. And she only gets more powerful every time I feel like someone writes her.
Number 10. Thor. Thor at number 10, you say? Blasphemy. Well, no, not really. Everybody, or most everyone, knows about Thor, the god of thunder, or the herald of thunder, in Donny Cates' run at least at the start of it. Thor is mauled off of the Norse god of the same name. He was cast out of Asgard, one of the Nine Realms, after his father found him to be too arrogant and a disappointment as an heir. Initially, he was sharing the body of a mortal man named Donald Blake, and Donald Blake was not aware of this. Not only was that horrifying, but it was also confusing. So it was soon retconned to the fact that he was Donald Blake, unless he held the hammer of Thor. And then when he put it down, he forgot. Which was still kind of convoluted, but it worked. Nowadays, Thor's secret identity days are long behind him, and now he is all Thor all the time. His status as a god doesn't actually seem to awe the people around him as much as it should. I guess they just got used to it, with him being an Avenger and all. He's just everywhere. They've been there and seen that. Number 9, Hercules. Hercules is a fairly prominent member of the Marvel Universe as well, but he doesn't get the same amount of attention. Definitely not on the same level as Thor. Hercules debuted back in the Silver Age of Marvel, or their Renaissance, because it wasn't even Marvel before the Silver Age. It was timely, before that was Atlas. Hercules got his start teaming up with Thor as his rival and eventually as his friend, but also still as his rival, like an anime. For some reason, the Grecian angle didn't really take as well as the Norse one. And while Hercules has his fans, he's certainly not as well known as some of the other characters out there. Although the importance of Simonson's run on Thor and how that defined him cannot be understated here. If you get a writer like, say, how Chris Claremont revolutionized the X-Men, you can suddenly get a whole new placement within the comic book universe. Number 8, Wonder Girl. Cassandra Sandsmark. Yes, if you're a demigod, you get to be on this list too. While Marvel's Hercules enjoys full godhood status, Zeus over in the DC universe is still doing what he loves, seducing mortal ladies, though hopefully he's not doing it in the form of a swan anymore. Creepy. Cassandra is the daughter of Zeus and an archaeologist named Dr. Helena Sandsmark, who is also a friend of Diana, aka Wonder Woman. So at first they play it off like Diana is giving Cassie items that grant her powers and is taking her under her wing, before it is later revealed that no, she is actually a daughter of Zeus. At least this was before the New 52. Then she was Zeus's granddaughter. Why? Cause why not? Retcon all the things. But hey, in Rebirth, Zeus refers to her as the future of the pantheon of the gods. So that's something. High praise. Or high pressure. You decide. Number 7, Storm. Now Storm is interesting on this list for the fact that she isn't actually a god, but her people thought she was. When her amazing mutant abilities manifested, that being the ability to control the weather, it appeared to the people of her village that she was a goddess. She could stop droughts, create plenty, and turn the tides in their favor. It's an understandable assumption, to be honest. Still, Xavier came and burst that bubble hard, and then took her away to harness her powers to a greater degree, and also in a more targeted manner. Though she was doing pretty well figuring out on her own, to be honest. Practice makes perfect, and compared to an average mere mortal, her powers do seem pretty godlike. Number 6, Snowbird. Snowbird first appeared in Uncanny X-Men number 120 back in 1979, and was actually a fan character for writer John Byrne, her creator. He was just waiting for a chance, essentially, an opportunity to write her, and with Alpha Flight, he got it. Snowbird is again a demigod, this time with a human father and a goddess mother, Nelvana, an Inuit goddess of the North. This wasn't exactly a romance, though. Like, her father's experiences in the spirit realm drove him insane. It was much more of a you produce offspring now. Narya was bound by a shaman to the Earth realm, where he attempted to raise her and give her some semblance of normalcy. But she grew rapidly and soon developed powers. Lots and lots of powers, such as being able to transform into any animal, well, any natively Canadian animal. So, you know, caveats. She would end up on the Canadian superhero team Alpha Flight. But it was a pretty big conflict, since she had been born to battle the forces of the tundra, so she had to kind of divide her attentions and eventually gave up her secret identity. Snowbird has many abilities aside from metamorphosis, and that includes healing. Again, people here know her origins, but they're pretty meh about it. She was born in the spirit realm. That's worth at least a conversation over coffee. Number 5, Orion. Orion is a member of Jack Kirby's New Gods universe. He is the son of Darkseid, traded with the High Father as a bid for peace between Apocalypse and New Genesis. Orion grew up in the paradise that was New Genesis, and was taught to focus his inherent anger, and he came to really appreciate the upbringing he had been given. However, his ancestry led him towards being their planet's most skilled warrior. He was aggressive and more ready for a fight than the other residents of New Genesis. Orion has been a member of the Justice League and helped them deal with Darkseid, his father. The New Gods get their godhood more from their names than anything else. They are slightly more powerful than most mortal humans, but they are also still below some of the Earth's forces. Darkseid is pretty terrifying though, and just the application of the Judeo-Christian Darkseid is when referring to him, that's some hardcore blasphemy right there. Number 4, Mr. Miracle. So since we're talking about this trade, let's look at the other half. While Orion got to live an idyllic childhood on New Genesis, the child the High Father gave to Darkseid, not so much. No, instead, he gave that child to the cruel Granny Goodness in an attempt to break his spirit and to prove to the High Father that his way was best and inescapable. In a joke to amuse herself, the child was named Scott Free and would spend his childhood trying to escape Apocalypse, using increasingly cleverer and cleverer methods. Scott was unaware of his heritage and yet still had an inherent bend towards freedom that led him to join the resistance against Darkseid, because he did eventually escape. Take that. Scott Free. He would end up on Earth eventually and love it there, especially the stable pace of life and lack of surprise torture at every corner. Number 3, Doctor Strange. Doctor Strange is usually the Sorcerer Supreme, but sometimes to shake up the status quo, that changes. And what we have instead is a powerless Stephen Strange, but he rarely stays that way for long. Case in point, when Loki became the Sorcerer Supreme, Doctor Strange could not just let that stand. So he had to set out to find a way to be stronger, better, faster. So since Loki stole his cloak, Doctor Strange broke into Asgard and made a bargain with the World Tree, Yggdrasil. Hard to say.
Real tree. The amount of magic that this tree of life granted him was so great, it turned him into a living god of magic. But since he really just wanted his life back, he was able to give up that godhood for his title, regular powers, and of course, his cloak. Number 2, Dr. Manhattan. Dr. Manhattan is transformed into the Watchmen universe's only superpowered being. His transformation is due to a tragic accident that results in his body being completely obliterated, disintegrated. But John Osterman came back. He came back changed though. He rebuilt himself molecule by molecule. He is no longer a man in the traditional sense, but a being of energy, a god. He exists now outside of time, or rather in all time periods simultaneously. Because of this, he began to get more and more disconnected from life and other people. He would eventually leave his universe to create one of his own. This would later be retconned to it being the DCU, or at least the New 52. There are many feelings about this. Mine are salty. But what are yours? I mean, I'm not as salty as the authors of the Three Jokers, who had to wait over an extra year to publish their comic because it had to wait till after this Watchmen DC crossover before it could come out. And there were art delays. Many art delays. Yikes. And in at number 1, we have God Doom. During the Secret Wars event of the 2010s, not of the 80s, the Marvel Universe essentially collapsed and it was remade by one man, keeping it all together, a world of merges and warps. And in this universe, he also stole Reed's family. This man was Doom, or God Doom as he was known in this arc. Doom stole the Beyonder's power in order to save all creation, so he was being good at the time. This is why he gets to be on a superhero list. Doom does what he wants when he wants though. Doom was the god of this world, but ultimately he is still Doom. So Reed and his evil alternate the Maker managed to find a way to approach him and restore the universe. What this really was a way to wrap up the 1610 universe, aka the Ultimate Universe, which had at this point run its course. That universe started in 2000 and ended in 2015. Basically, they wanted to save the characters that they liked and shut down the rest, but in a way that if for some reason they needed to have them back in the future, they could. Basically, have your cake and eat it too. We want Miles Morales and the Maker, and that's pretty much it.
Kicking off the list at number 10, The Flash. Of course, this one is epic. We gotta start with it. In part one of this list, we talked about when Batman sat upon the Mobius chair, so it's only fair if we take a look at Barry Allen's fun little upgrade in Darkseid War Chapter 4, The Death of Darkseid. Now this is when Darkseid's daughter Grail summons the Anti-Monitor to go toe-to-toe with Big Guns himself. So Darkseid summoned the Black Racer in retaliation, but when the Anti-Monitor stripped the Racer of Darkseid's control, it was then merged with Barry Allen, which is quite the combination. And then after that point, he was able to take on Darkseid a little easier, to say the least. Number 9, Doctor Strange. When we're talking about superheroes becoming a god, Doctor Strange wouldn't be far off that description as it is. I mean, he's quite cosmic as it is, but in Doctor Strange issue 385, the Sorcerer Supreme lost the mantle to, well, Loki. Loki's tricks made Steven hand over his magical possessions and the Sanctum Sanctorum, everything that belonged to him that made him special. He was like, bye, gotta go. So Strange had to become a veterinarian, just a total career flip, which is great. So then Strange had to break into Asgard, find the World Tree, and then once he was there, Strange had to make an offering, and the tree opened his third eye, so he found what needed to be done. He had to make an offering, a sacrifice, really, so he grabbed Bats, his dog, who Loki kind of already took care of, and then Strange felt nothing like before. He felt more magic than he's ever known. And after this point, Strange says he can see everything, because he is everything. He is a god of magic. Kind of like David Blaine. And before we continue on with this list, if you want to go ahead and give this video a thumbs up, that would be great. You're the best. Thank you so much for your support. Now let's get right back into this list. No more wasted time. Number 8, Batman. Okay, back in 1994, best year ever, comic book fans were delighted when the Elseworlds storylines were launched. Now there was one shot that had Bruce Wayne become a Green Lantern, and it was pretty epic. A couple times superheroes become lanterns, and I'm gonna count them as a god for a few of them, because, well, you can't really argue it too much. Batman in Darkest Night finds Bruce Wayne starting his path as the Caped Crusader, but that's when Abin Sur crashes down to Earth, and that ring that once belonged to him has to find a suitable replacement. Now it ended up finding Bruce Wayne instead of Hal Jordan. And he looks great as a lantern. I mean, honestly, his skills already mixed with his new ability makes him unstoppable, really. I mean, Bruce wasn't the only one to acquire a ring also. The Rogue Lantern, Sinestro, merged with Joe Chill, the guy who was responsible for the death of Bruce's parents. So the stakes are high, the punches are hard, it's a good time. If you haven't checked out Batman in Darkest Night, I suggest you do it, especially if you're looking for more Batman godly type comics. That's the way to go. Number 7, Cosmic Spider-Man. Of course, we gotta use this guy. Cosmic Spider-Man, aka Captain Universe, is one of the most powerful versions of the web-slinger. Cosmic Spidey went toe-to-toe with Rune King Thor and beat him. He was like, eh, no problem, I can do it again. Cosmic Spider-Man isn't from our Earth, he's actually from Earth 13. That's where he retains the power of the Enigma Force, and he first appeared in Amazing Spider-Man Volume 3, Issue 9. Now, Cosmic Spidey can't leave his universe or else, well, he would lose the Enigma Force. That's why the resistance of spider heroes always goes to Earth 13. They're like, hey, don't leave, we need you with the powers, we'll come to your house. It's kind of like when your friend's on house arrest and you're like, you know what, we'll come to your place tonight. You know, those scenarios that we're all in. What a weird example. He meets his demise only a couple issues later, but it was fun while it lasted. When the Inheritors were hunting down Spider-Man, their leader Solas drained the Enigma Force from Peter, but we can find more of him in What If Volume 2, Issue 31, titled What If Spider-Man Had Kept Those Cosmic Powers. You see the best of both worlds, Miley Cyrus style. Number 6, Black Widow. In What If? Age of Ultron, Issue 3, one of our timelines gets a little messy. See, the Midgard Serpent took down all of the Avengers. It was just wreaking havoc, and it killed them all. Well, I mean, mostly all of them. See, Thor bites the bullet during this battle, which leads to Ragnarok, and then everybody who has superpowers is just not around anymore. It's bad. So a whole month goes by with Natasha and the team trying to stay alive, battling every day, then eventually, Natasha comes up with her own little secret side quest. Mjolnir is in the same spot as it was before. Obviously. So while the team is going forward with their own plan of blasting every weapon that they have at the serpent, Natasha sneaks off, reaches out for Mjolnir, reminds the team that they're a bunch of regular humans fighting a god's war, and then seconds later becomes a god herself. The old serpent situation was a little easier to handle after that. I gotta say, Natasha looks pretty good with the hammer. Looks pretty, she could probably kill a lot of people with that. Number 5, the Golden Oldie. Okay, now hear me out. I know Aunt May can't swing building to building like Peter. She wasn't a hero before, technically, but she was one in Marvel Team-Up 134, in many ways. See, it's Aunt May, Franklin Richards, and Galactus. The classic trio. After Nova died due to his lack of energy, Galactus came to our rock in space and asked for Reed Richards to help out. Well, rather, he finds Franklin Richards and picks him as the new Herald. But Aunt May steps in front of him to prevent this from happening. So I'm gonna say that this moment right here, this regular human saving the day, Aunt May, she is now a hero. It's decided, now she's a hero. And then page 12 and 13, just seconds later, she becomes the Golden Oldie, which already sounds epic. But then when Aunt May finds out from Franklin that Galactus has a thing for Twinkies, the new Herald of Galactus, Golden Oldie Aunt May, searches the universe far and wide until she finds the best planet in the world, the Twinkie planet. So yummy. Which is a much more delicious planet for Galactus when it comes to feeding time. So she saved the day and also the planet. Way to go, Aunt May. Number 4, Captain America. Yeah, I should probably mention this one, seeing that I almost choked on my peanut M&Ms when it happened. Captain America, Tony Stark, and Thor, the big three, are going toe-to-toe with Thanos and Avengers Endgame in the third act. Now, the odds aren't looking good at this time. All the snapped heroes haven't really returned yet, so it's still looking not good. Tony is unconscious, Thor is about to get his own axe through his chest, and then Steve hucks Mjolnir at Thanos, and then the theater went nuts. Cap plus the hammer of the gods equals really fun CGI, a lot of good CGI. Cap lifted Mjolnir back in the late 80s in Thor 390, titled The Hero and the Hammer. So it's happened once before. But when Cap had the hammer, he didn't really enjoy the powers of a god. He said they were intoxicating, sure, but it belonged to Thor, so he quickly tossed it back to its rightful owner. What a gem. But those six guys got smoked by Cap with the hammer in that initial pull. Like, as soon as he picked it up, those six guys are like, that was crazy. Iron Man was actually the first to lift the hammer back in Avengers 122, back in the mid 70s. But then the hammer rules were a little bit different. You see, you could lift the hammer if you were in space, and you could lift it if Thor was also lifting at the same time, but like, it doesn't really count. It's like when your little brother plays a game with you, but the controller's not plugged in. It's like, it looks cool, but you're not doing much. Number 3, Barry Allen. Making his first debut in Showcase Issue 4 way back in the 1950s, Barry Allen, aka The Flash, aka the fastest man alive, has been a founding member of the Justice League, and after an experiment gave him super speed, he's been saving the day at blink and you'll miss it speeds. But then during the events of Blackest Night, Barry is being targeted by a black ring and is forced to get out of there, or else, you know, he joined the others as a Black Lantern. And then in Issue 2 of Blackest Night, The Flash, Barry, is chosen to be the wielder of the blue power ring of hope, which adds to the super speed stuff quite a bit. So now he has the ability to heal other lanterns, and now he could even fly on top of his speed, which is pretty new for Barry. His imagination is only the limit here when it comes to powers, and he ends up partnering with fellow Blue Lantern, Saint Walker, in order to save Barry's grandson, Bart Allen. So it really works out for the best. They kind of kill it. Number 2, Mr. Fantastic. Since the early Fantastic Four days back in the 60s, Reed Richards has been known to be the stretchy smart guy, right? Now, in fact, he's considered one of the smartest people on Earth. He's a polymath who's mastered all of the sciences, be it electrical, chemistry, physics, aerospace engineering, that's a big one. But after the events of Secret Wars, Reed got an even bigger advantage when he convinced Molecule Man to strip Dr. Doom of his powers and instead give Reed the Omega upgrade. So after this, Mr. Fantastic was able to destroy Battleworld, rebuild Earth 616, and also bring his family back from the dead. Must be nice, that's pretty sick. And finally, number one, Superman. Yeah, whenever the Man of Steel gets another upgrade, it's bound to be pretty impressive, even closer to God level. Now, I know he was already a god before, kind of, with his powers, but it just gets even better. Before Darkseid and the Anti-Monitor went against each other in Darkseid War, Superman and Lex were taken to Apocalypse, which was a mess, of course. And on top of that, there wasn't a sun in the sky, so Superman was getting to that 20% battery notification pretty quickly. Things aren't looking hopeful. He's losing his powers, it's not looking great. Lex had this brilliant last resort idea where Superman would fly down into the planet because it's filled with sun fire. Sure, not a bad call at all. But what ends up happening is far greater than they expected. The dark energy charged Superman back up, but it also turned him into a negative version. Not like, you know, he was sad, he didn't listen to like Evanescence and stuff, but he was the god of strength now, and also his morals just went out the window, so it made for a pretty entertaining ride. It was a nice change. Kicking off the list at number 10, we have Iron Man. The Fear Itself storyline is a wild ride. The Serpent is after Earth, and people are getting turned into statues. It is a absolute nightmare. Tony is fighting Mach in the streets of Paris and it's not looking good. So now we need another plan. What's plan B? Plan B was Tony getting permission from Odin himself, forge a weapon of his own on Nidavellir. Now Tony ends up making weapons for the entire team after sobering up. He was really slamming drinks down and then he prayed to Odin. You know, really going through it. And then in issue 7, Tony and the team now have an Asgardian makeover. Just walking, talking hammers of Thor, basically. Now they of course won, everything went back to normal, but Tony destroyed the weapons afterwards because, you know, you can't have those things lying around, obviously. Number 9, Starlord. Okay, we gotta go to film just for one point here because we can't leave this one out. At the end of Guardians of the Galaxy 1, Peter Quill, aka Starlord, was able to hold an Infinity Stone with his bare hands. He held the Power Stone. Now, this didn't go unnoticed. Even groups of beings in the past have tried to do that by sharing the power amongst all of them, and it never works. They end up going like, whoa, and they turn to skeletons. Now, his real father turned out to be a celestial. He was a living planet. His name was Ego. Rightfully so. So Ego goes around and he like reproduces all over the galaxy and then he wipes the planets out. He gets bigger and stronger. He's a god. Peter Quill's now a god as well. They're playing god, son, and father catch. So as long as Ego's alive, Star-Lord is basically a god. We have a big celestial battle at the end of the movie where he's fighting his dad and he's turning into Pac-Man. It's kind of weird. It's a little dumb, but it's fun. So once Ego was taken care of, Peter lost his god powers and went back to just normal, plain old Star-Lord, which is still pretty cool. I'm kind of glad he's not a god because that was a weird part. I mean, it would have been helpful in Infinity War. Maybe all those punches to Thanos' face would have done some damage rather than, you know, kill everyone. Number 8, Crystal. She made her first debut in Fantastic Four issue 45, and she was the second child born from Inhumans, Quillen, and Amber. Now, she actually brought Quicksilver back to Adalon to heal him, then the two fell in love there. She's basically a god. I have to include her because, I mean, she's pretty underrated. She has a bunch of these incredible abilities, and one of those abilities is atomic manipulation. She can rearrange atoms and all of the elements as well. She can control anything in the universe, basically. That plus her ability to levitate without the help of any elemental powers. I don't really know what else to call her. She's definitely a god. And if she ever is under attack, she can use air molecules and bind them together psionically and then make a force field for herself. So you don't want to mess with Crystal. Very underrated, 100%. Number 7, Wolverine. Wolverine's been known to be the time travel guy. He makes the confusing runs because his regeneration ability allows him to really go deep. It gives him the advantage in Days of Future Past type plots. Now in Uncanny X-Men Annual, a villain named Horde comes in and wipes the entire team out, Wolverine included. But a single drop of blood saves the day. A single drop from Wolverine falls onto the crystal of Ultimate Vision, and then bam, Wolverine now leveled up. He regrows his body with his new power, and then he brings the pain down on Horde. It's unreal. It's pretty amazing to see. Like, Logan is just so happy in these scenes. I mean, obviously, he's a god, but he knows all the secrets of the universe. He's finally had peace. Look at him. He even referenced another X-Men who once became a god herself. That X-Men being? Number 6, Jean Grey. Jean Grey is a mutant being born with telekinetic and telepathic powers. She was one of the original members of the X-Men, and seeing the potential in Jean's strength, the Phoenix Force attached itself to her while she was in danger during a space mission with the Fantastic Four. That all happens during X-Men issue 101. So now she's a Dark Phoenix and she's full of power, full on God mode. This dark, powerful cosmic force started to change her for the worse. She ended up destroying a solar system that killed billions of people. And then it ended up taking her own life in order to keep the universe safe. So a few years later, it was revealed that it wasn't actually the Jean Grey that had died. It was just the Phoenix as a separate entity that had taken over her mind and all that stuff. The Phoenix Saga is one of the biggest transformations to an X-Men member. If you haven't read it, go check it out immediately. Number 5, Kurth. This one comes from Fear Itself storyline. Juggernaut was already pretty terrifying to begin with, but then you got an upgrade and a prison was destroyed. It was a mess. The Hammer of Kurth was one of the 7 mystical warhammers that the Serpent summoned to awaken the Worthy. Remember that Serpent guy that I mentioned earlier? That's the same one. So the Hammer crashed onto the raft and Juggernaut just happened to be detained at the raft at that exact time. And the most frightening and obvious and most entertaining thing happened. He was quickly turned into Kurth Breaker of Stone, which sounds even more scary than Juggernaut, somehow. He attacked a nearby guard with one hit and the shockwave was so powerful that the prison and all the land around it just exploded. And at the same time, Hulk became Null Breaker of Worlds. So it was a mess. Whoever had to sweep up the streets after this, their back must be in so much pain. Number 4, Kid Omega. Quintavious Quire made his first appearance in X-Men issue 134. He's been described as one of the most powerful telepaths next to Jean Grey. He stood out to Professor X as a brilliant student and his abilities were never crystal clear. On his birthday, when he was still young, he received this fantastic phone call from his parents to say that he was adopted. Yeah, happy birthday, worst gift ever. So from then on, it went downhill. He got this Omega tattoo that he covered over the X tattoo, and he was in the Omega Gang now, and the Omega Gang handled humans that committed crimes against mutants in their own dark way. So he was troubled, to say the least. But things got harder for him when the Phoenix Force came along, as things always do. This happens in Wolverine in the X-Men issue 37. Quentin gets a good look at the Phoenix Force when he becomes an avatar to it, and his future self was shown to be a host as well. Real trippy moment for him. Number 3, Batman. The Mobius chair is a pretty powerful chair. It made its first appearance in New Gods issue 1, and the chair was created by Mobius himself, aka the Anti-Monitor. Now he gave the chair to Metron, but Metron slipped up one day, and Batman ended up becoming a god for a hot minute. It's pretty sweet. Wonder Woman grabbed Metron with her lasso and pulled his ass right off, and right before he could summon boom tubes, Batman just jumped on it like musical chairs. And then the Dark Knight becomes a bright light. He became the god of knowledge. Batman became the god of knowledge. What an upgrade that was. The whole team is fighting Darkseid and Batman is just floating in this chair, figuring the universe out the entire time. Like, oh my god. He's searching the cosmos for answers and it's honestly quite the spectacle to read. And as if things couldn't get better for him, add a power ring into the mix. Yeah, this guy was literally unstoppable. Number 2, Supergirl. Kara Zor-El was 15 years old when her cousin Kal-El was born. She was launched into space right before Krypton's demise and spent 2 decades orbiting Earth's sun while she remained in stasis. Now her pod eventually crashed down in Siberia and these giant armed robots started to, you know, try and fight her. Now when she fought back, she learned that she wasn't the same. She learned that she was a lot stronger than whatever the hell was around her. And then when Superman himself showed up, the two fought as she didn't really recognize the stranger or believe him about Krypton's, you know. So right off the bat, she's got a lot of rage and confusion inside of her. Now this rage had a chance to come out and get even with the world when she became the Red Daughter of Krypton. This was an ultimate upgrade, definitely counting this as becoming a god. I mean, look at her, that's pretty cosmic and unstoppable. I don't really know what else to call her. And as crazy as it may sound, joining the Red Lanterns helped Kara get over her anger and isolation issues, and she gained emotional stability from it. Get over your depression in these easy steps, just become a god. 4 issues later in Red Lanterns 32, Guy Gardner kicked her out for her own safety. But for that bit of time, Kara was probably loving life. And finally, number 1, Wonder Woman. Now I know Wonder Woman is already basically a god, being the daughter of Zeus and all, but once she became a god of war in the New 52. Wonder Woman issue 23 and 24, we find Wonder Woman taking on the Firstborn, but it wasn't looking good for Diana. She needed help until she went god mode on everybody. Diana has to make the hard choice of driving a spear through Firstborn and Ares. So Ares gave Diana congratulations for being a mighty warrior, and Wonder Woman spared the Firstborn's life and took Ares to the River Styx. And then when Wonder Woman returned, the gods declared her the new God of War.